Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ring Around the Sun by Clifford D. Simak. Narrated by Chris Sorensen. Chapter 1. Vickers got up at an hour outrageous for its earliness because Anne had phoned the night before to tell him about a man in New York she wanted him to meet. He had tried to argue about it. "I know it breaks into your schedule, Jay," she had said, "but I don't think this is something you can pass up." "I can't do it, Anne," he'd told her. "I've got the writing going now, and I can't get loose."
"But this is big," Anne had said. "The biggest thing that has ever broken. They picked you to talk to first ahead of all the other writers. They think you are the man to do it."
"Publicity."
"This is not publicity. This is something else."
"Forget it. I won't meet the guy, whoever he is," he had said, and hung up. But here he was, making himself an early breakfast and getting ready to go into New York. He was frying eggs and bacon and making toast and trying to keep one eye on the coffee maker, which was temperamental, when the doorbell rang. He wrapped his robe around him and headed for the door. It might be the newsboy. He had been out on the regular collection day, and the boy probably had seen the light in the kitchen. Or it might be his neighbor, the strange old man named Horton Flanders, who had moved in a year or so ago, and who dropped over to spend an idle hour at the most unexpected and inconvenient times. He was an affable old man and distinguished-looking, although slightly moth-eaten and shabby at the edges, pleasant to talk with and a good companion, even though Vickers might have wished that he were more orthodox in his visiting. It might be the newsboy, or it might be Flanders. It could scarcely be anyone else at this early hour. He opened the door, and a little girl stood there, wrapped in a cherry-colored bathrobe and with bunny rabbit slippers on her feet. Her hair was tousled from a night of sleep, but her blue eyes sparkled at him, and she smiled a pretty smile.
"Good morning, Mr. Vickers," she said. "I woke up and couldn't go back to sleep, and I saw the light burning in your kitchen and I thought maybe you was sick."
"I'm all right, Jane," Vickers told her. "I'm just getting breakfast. Maybe you would like to eat with me."
"Oh, yes," said Jane. "I was hoping maybe if you was eating breakfast, you'd ask me to eat with you."
"Your mother doesn't know you're here, does she?"
"Mommy and Daddy are asleep," said Jane. "This is the day that Daddy doesn't work, and they was out awful late last night. I heard them when they came in, and Mommy was telling Daddy that he drank too much, and she said she wouldn't go out with him never again if he drank that much, and Daddy..."
"Jane," said Vickers firmly, "I don't think your Mommy and Daddy would like you to be telling this."
"Oh, they don't care. Mommy talks about it all the time. I heard her telling Mrs. Traynor she had half a mind to divorce my daddy. Mr. Vickers, what is divorce?"
"Now, I don't know," said Vickers. "I can't recall I ever heard the word before. Maybe we oughtn't to talk about what your mommy said. And look, you got your slippers all wet crossing the grass."
"It's kind of wet outside. The dew is awful heavy."
"You come in," said Vickers, "and I'll get a towel and dry your feet, and then we'll have some breakfast and call your mommy so she knows where you are." She came in, and he closed the door. "You sit on that chair," he said, "and I'll get a towel. I'm afraid you might catch cold."
"Mr. Vickers, you aren't married, are you?"
"Why, no. It happens that I'm not."
"Most everyone is married," said Jane. "Most everyone I know. Why aren't you married, Mr. Vickers?"
"Why, I don't rightly know. Never found a girl, I guess."
"There are lots of girls."
"There was a girl," said Vickers. "A long time ago, there was a girl." It had been years since he had remembered sharply. He had forced the years to obscure the memory, to soften it and hide it away so that he did not think of it, and that if he did think of it, to make it so far away and hazy that he could quit thinking of it. But here it was again. There had been a girl, and an enchanted valley they had walked in, A springtime valley he remembered with the pink of wild crabapple blossoms flaming on the hills and the song of bluebird and of lark soaring in the sky. And there had been a wild spring breeze that ruffled the water and blew along the grass so that the meadow seemed to flow and become a lake with whitecaps rolling on it. They had walked in the valley, and there was no doubt that it was enchanted, for when he had gone back again, the valley wasn't there, or at least not the same valley. It had been, he remembered, a very different valley. He had walked there 20 years ago, and through all of the 20 years he had hidden it away, back in the attic of his mind. Yet here it was again, as fresh and shining as if it had been only yesterday.
"Mr. Vickers," said Jane, "I think your toast is burning."
Chapter 2. After Jane had gone and he had washed the dishes, he remembered that he had intended for a week or more to phone Joe about the mice.
"I got mice," Vickers told him.
"You got what?"
"Mice," said Vickers. "Little animals. They run around the place."
"Now that's funny," said Joe. "A well-built place like yours, it shouldn't have no mice. You want me to come over and get rid of them?"
"I guess you'll have to. I tried traps, but these mice don't go for traps. Got a cat a while back, and the cat left. Only stayed a day or two."
"Now that's a funny thing. Cats like places where they can catch a mouse."
"This cat was crazy," said Vickers. "Acted like it was spooked. Walked around on tiptoe."
"Cats is funny animals," Joe confided.
"I'm going down to the city today. Figure you could do it while I'm gone?"
"Sure thing," said Joe. "The exterminating business is kind of slack right now. I'll come over 10 o'clock or so."
"I'll leave the front door unlocked," said Vickers.
He hung up the phone and got the paper off the stoop. At his desk, he laid down the paper and picked up the sheaf of manuscript, holding it in his hand, feeling the thickness of it and the weight of it, as if by its thickness and its weight he might reassure himself that what it held was good, that it was not a labor wasted, that it said the many things he wished them to say, and said them well enough that other men and women might read the words and know the naked thought that lay behind the coldness of the print. He should not waste the day, he told himself. He should stay here and work. He should not go traipsing off to meet this man his agent wanted him to meet. But Anne had been insistent, and had said that it was important, and even when he had told her about the car being in the garage for repairs, she still had insisted that he come. That story about the car had been untrue, of course, for he knew even as he told her that Eb would have it ready for him to make the trip. He looked at his watch and saw he had no more than half an hour until Eb's garage would open, and half an hour was not worth his while to spend in writing. He picked up the paper and went out on the porch to read the morning's news. He thought about little Jane and what a sweet child she was, and how she'd praised his cooking and had chattered on and on. "You aren't married," Jane had said. "Why aren't you married, Mr. Vickers?" And he had said, "Once there was a girl. I remember now, once there was a girl." Her name had been Kathleen Preston, and she had lived in a big brick house that sat up on a hill, a many-columned house with a wide porch and fan lights above the doors, an old house that had been built in the first flush of pioneer optimism when the country had been new, and the house had stood when the land had failed and ran away in ditches and left the hillside scarred with gullied yellow clay. He had been young then, so young that it hurt him now to think of it. So young he could not understand that a girl who lived in an old ancestral home with fan lights above the doors and a pillared portico could not seriously consider a boy whose father farmed a worn-out farm where the corn grew slight and sickly. Or rather, perhaps it had been her family that could not consider it, for she too must have been too young to fully understand. Perhaps she had quarreled with her family. Perhaps there had been angry words and tears. That was something he had never known. For between that walk down the enchanted valley and the next time he had called, they had bundled her off to a school somewhere in the east, and that was the last time he had seen or heard of her. For remembrance sake, he had walked the valley again, alert to catch something that would spell out for him the enchantment of that day he had walked with her. But the crabapples had dropped their blossoms, and the lark did not sing so well, and the enchantment had fled into some never-never land. She had taken the magic with her. The paper fell out of his lap, and he bent to pick it up. Opening it, he saw that the news was following the same drab pattern of all other days. The latest peace rumor still was going strong, and the Cold War still was in full cry. The Cold War had been going on for years, of course, and gave promise of going on for many more. The last 40 years had seen crisis after crisis, rumor after rumor, near war always threatening and big war never breaking out, until a Cold War-weary world yawned in the face of the new peace rumors and the crises that were a dime a dozen. Someone at an obscure college down in Georgia had set a new record at raw egg gulping, and a glamorous movie star was on the verge of changing husbands once again, and the steelworkers were threatening to strike. There was a lengthy feature article about missing persons, and he read about half of it, all that he wanted to. It seemed that more and more people were dropping out of sight all the time, whole families at a time, and the police throughout the land were getting rather frantic. There always had been people who disappeared, the article said, but they had been individuals. Now, two or three families would disappear from the same community, and two or three from another community, and there was no trace of them at all. Usually, they were from the poorer brackets. In the past, when individuals had dropped from sight, there had usually been some reason for it. But in these cases of mass disappearances, there seemed to be no reason beyond poverty. And why one would or could disappear because of poverty was something the article writer and the people he had interviewed could not figure out. There was a headline that read, "More Worlds Than One," says Savant. He read part of the story. Boston, Massachusetts, AP. There may be another Earth just a second ahead of us, and another world a second behind us, and another world a second behind that one, and another world a second behind, well, you get the idea. A sort of continuous chain of worlds, one behind the other. That is the theory of Dr. Vincent Aldridge. Vickers let the paper drop to the floor and sat looking out across the garden, rich with flowers and ripe with sunshine. There was peace here in this garden corner of the world, if there were nowhere else, he thought. A peace compounded of many things, of golden sunshine and the talk of summer leaves quivering in the wind, of bird and flower and sundial, of picket fence that needed painting, and an old pine tree dying quietly and tranquilly, taking its time to die, being friends with the grass and flowers and other trees all the while it died. Here there was no rumor and no threat. Here was calm acceptance of the fact that time ran on, that winter came and summer, that sun would follow moon, and that the life one held was a gift to be cherished rather than a right that one must wrest from other living things. Vickers glanced at his watch and saw that it was time to go. Chapter 3. Eb, the garage man, hitched up his greasy breeches and squinted his eyes against the smoke from the cigarette that hung from one corner of a grease-smeared mouth. "You see, it's this way, Jay," he explained. "I didn't fix your car." "I was going to the city," said Vickers, "but if my car's not fixed, you won't be needing that car anymore. Guess that's really why I didn't fix it. Told myself it would be just a waste of money." "It's not that bad," protested Vickers. "It may look ramshackle, but it still has lots of miles."
"Sure, it's got some miles in it, but you're going to be buying this new Forever car."
"Forever car," Vickers repeated. "That's a queer name for a car."
"No, it isn't," Eb told him stubbornly. "It'll really last forever. That's why they call it the Forever car, because it lasts forever. Fellow was in here yesterday and told me about it and asked if I wanted to take it on, and I said sure I would. And this fellow, he said I was smart to take it on because he said there isn't going to be any other car selling except this Forever car.
Now, wait a minute, said Vickers. They may call it a forever car, but it won't last forever. No car would last forever. 20 years, maybe, or a lifetime, maybe, but not forever.
Jay, declared Eb. That's what this fella told me. Buy one of them, he says, and use it all your life. When you die, will it to your son, and when he dies, he can will it to his son, and so on down the line. It's guaranteed to last forever. Anything goes wrong with it, and they'll fix it up or give you a new one. All except the tires. You gotta buy the tires. They wear out just like on any other car. And paint, too. But the paint is guaranteed 10 years. If it goes bad sooner than 10 years, you get a new job free.
It might be possible, said Vickers, but I hardly think so. I don't doubt a car could be made to last a lot longer than the ones do now, but if they were built too well, there'd be no replacement. It stands to reason a manufacturer in his right mind wouldn't build a car that would last forever. He'd put himself out of business. In the first place, it would cost too much.
That's where you're wrong, Eb told him. 1,500 smackers, that's all you pay. No accessories to buy, no build-ups. You get it complete for 1,500.
Not much to look at, I suppose.
It's the classiest job you ever laid your eyes on.
Fellow that was here was driving one of them, and I looked it over good.
Any color that you want. Lots of chrome and stainless steel. All the latest gadgets. And drive? Man, that thing drives like $1,000,000. But it might take some getting used to. I went to open the hood and take a look at the motor and, you know, that hood doesn't open. What are you doing there? This fellow asked me, and I told him I wanted to look at the motor. There isn't any need to, this fellow says. Nothing ever goes wrong with it. You never need to get at it. But I ask him, where do you put in the oil? And you know what he said? Well, sir, he said, you don't put in no oil. All you put in is gasoline, he tells me.
I'll have a dozen or so of them in within a day or so, said Eb.
You better let me save you one.
Vickers shook his head. I'm short on money.
That's another thing about it. This company gives you a good trade-in value. I figure I could give you $1,000 for that wreck of yours.
It's not worth $1,000, Deb.
I know it's not. Fella says give them more than they're worth. Don't worry about what you give them. We'll make it right with you.
It doesn't exactly seem the smart way to do business, come to think about it, but if that's the way they want to operate, I won't say a word against it.
I'd have to think about it. That would leave $500 for you to pay.
And I can make it easy on you.
Fella said I should make it easy.
Says they aren't so much interested in the money right now as getting a few of them forever cars out running on the road.
I don't like the sound of it, protested Vickers. Here this company springs up overnight with no announcement at all with a brand new car. You think there would have been something in the papers about it? If I were putting out a new car, I'd plaster the country with advertising. Big ads in the newspapers, announcements on television, billboards every mile or so.
Well, you know, said Eb, I thought of that one too. I said, look, you fellas want me to sell this car, and how am I going to sell it when you aren't advertising it? How am I going to sell it when no one knows about it?
And he said they figured the car was so good everyone would up and tell everybody else.
Said there isn't any advertising that can beat word of mouth. Said they'd rather save the money they put in advertising and cut down the cost of the car. Said there was no reason to make the consumer pay for the cost of an advertising campaign.
I can't understand it.
It does sort of hit you that way, Eb admitted. This gang that's putting out the forever car isn't losing any money on it. You can bet your boots on that. Be crazy if they did. And if they aren't losing any money at it, can you imagine what the rest of them companies have been making all these years? $2,000 or $3,000 for a pile of junk that falls apart second time you take it out? Makes you shiver to think of the money they've been making, don't it?
When you get the cars in, said Vickers, I'll be down to take a look at them.
We might make a deal at that.
Sure, said Eb.
Be sure to do that. You say you was going to the city?
Vickers nodded.
Be a bus along any minute now, said Eb.
Catch it down at the drugstore corner. Get you there in a couple of hours. Those fellows really wheel it.
I guess I could take a bus. I never thought of it.
I'm sorry about the car, said Eb. If I'd have known you was going to use it, I'd have fixed her up. Not much wrong with it. But I wanted to see what you thought about this other deal before I run you up a bill.
The drugstore coroner looked somehow unfamiliar, and Vickers puzzled about it as he walked down the street toward it. Then, when he got closer, he saw what it was that was unfamiliar. Several weeks ago, old Hans, the shoe repairman, had taken to his bed and died, and the shoe repair shop, which had stood next to the drugstore for almost uncounted years, finally had been closed. Now it was open again, or at least the display window had been washed, something which old Hans had never bothered to do in all his years, and there was a display of some sort. And there was a sign. Vickers had been so intent on figuring out what was wrong with the window that he did not see the sign until he was almost even with the store. The sign was new and neatly lettered, and it said, Gadget Shop. Vickers stopped before the window and looked at what was inside. A layer of black velvet had been laid along the display strip, and arranged upon it were three items. A cigarette lighter, a razor blade, and a single light bulb. Nothing else. Just those three items. There were no signs, no advertising, no prices. There was no need of any. Anyone who saw that window, Vickers knew, would recognize the items, although the store would not sell only those. There would be a couple of dozen others, each of them in its own way as distinguished and efficient as the three lying on the strip of velvet. There was a tapping sound along the walk, and Vickers turned when it came close to him. It was his neighbor, Horton Flanders, out for his morning walk with his slightly shabby, carefully brushed clothes and his smart Malacca cane. No one else, Vickers told himself, would have the temerity to carry a cane along the streets of Cliffwood. Mr. Flanders saluted him with the cane and moved in to stand beside him and stare at the window.
So, they're branching out, he said.
Apparently, Vickers agreed.
Most peculiar outfit, said Mr. Flanders. You may know, although I presume you don't, that I have been most interested in this company. Just a matter of curiosity, you understand. I am curious, I might add, about many different things.
I hadn't noticed, Vickers said.
Oh my, yes, said Mr. Flanders. About so many things. About the carbohydrates, for instance. Most intriguing setup, don't you think so, Mr. Vickers?
I hadn't given it much thought. I've been so busy that I'm afraid.
There's something going on, said Mr. Flanders. I tell you that there is.
The bus came down the street, passed them, and braked to a stop at the drugstore corner.
I'm afraid I shall have to leave you, Mr. Flanders, Vickers said. I'm going to the city.
If I'm back tonight, why don't you drop over?
Oh, I will, Mr. Flanders told him. I nearly always do.
Chapter 4. It had been the blade first, the razor blade that would not wear out. And after that, the lighter that never failed to light, that required no flints and never needed filling. Then the light bulb that would burn forever if it met no accident. Now it was the forever car. Somewhere in there, too, would be the synthetic carbohydrates. There is something going on, Mr. Flanders had said to him, standing there in front of old Hans's shop. Vickers sat in his seat next to the window, well back in the bus, and tried to sort it out in his mind. There was a tie-up somewhere. Razor blades, lighters, light bulbs, synthetic carbohydrates, and now the forever car. Somewhere there must be a common denominator to explain why it should be these five items and not five other things, say roller curtains and pogo sticks and yo-yos and airplanes and toothpaste. Razor blades shaved a man, and light bulbs lit his way, and a cigarette lighter would light a cigarette, and the synthetic carbohydrates had ironed out at least one international crisis and had saved some millions of people from starvation or war. There is something going on, Flanders had said, standing there in neat but shabby clothes, and with that ridiculous stick clutched in his fist. although come to think of it, it was not ridiculous when Mr. Flanders held it. The forever car would run forever, and it used no oil, and when you died, you willed it to your son, and when he died, he willed it to his son, and if your great-great-grandfather bought one of the cars and you were the eldest son of the eldest son, you would have it too. One car would outlast many generations. But it would do more than that. It would close every automotive plant in a year or so. It would shut down most of the garages and repair shops. It would be a blow to the steel industry and the glass industry and the fabric makers and perhaps a dozen other industries as well. The razor blade hadn't seemed important, nor the light bulb, nor the lighter, but now they suddenly all were. Thousands of men would lose their jobs and they would come home and face the family and say, "Well, this is it. After all these years, I haven't got a job." The family would go about their everyday affairs in tight and terrible silence, with a queer air of dread hanging over them, and the man would buy all the newspapers and study the want ad columns, then go out and walk the streets, and men in little cages or at desks in the outer offices would shake their heads at him. Finally, the man would go to one of those little places that had the sign, "Carbohydrates Inc." over its door, and he would shuffle in with the embarrassment of a good workman who cannot find a job, and he would say, "I'm a little down on my luck, and the cash is running low. I wonder..." A man behind the desk would say, "Why, sure. How many in your family?" The man would tell him, and the one who was at the desk would write on a slip of paper and hand it to him. "That window over there," he'd say. "I figure there's enough there to last you for a week, but if there isn't, be sure to come back any time you want to." The man would take the slip of paper and try to say his thanks, but the carbohydrates man would brush them easily aside and say, "Look, now that's what we're here for. This is our business, helping guys like you." The man would go to the window, and the man behind the window would look at the slip of paper and hand him packages, and one package would be synthetic stuff that tasted like potatoes, and another one would taste like bread, and there would be others that would make you think you were eating corn or peas. That was what had happened before. That was what was happening all the time. It wasn't like relief. Anyhow, you could say it wasn't like relief. These carbohydrates people didn't ever insult you when you came to ask for help. They treated you like a paying customer, and they always said that you should come back. And sometimes when you didn't, they came around to see what had happened, if maybe you had got a job or were bashful about coming in again. If it turned out that you were bashful, they'd sit down and talk to you, and before they left, they had you thinking you were doing them a favor by taking the carbohydrates off their hands. Because of the carbohydrates, millions who would have died were still alive in India and in China. Now, the thousands who would lose their jobs when the automotive plants shut down and the steel mills curtailed their operations and the repair shops shut their doors would travel the same trail to the doors with a carbohydrates sign. The automotive industry would have to shut down. No one would buy any other car when you could walk down the street and buy one that would last forever. Just as the razor blade industry was already closing its doors, now that it was possible to get an everlasting blade at the gadget shops. The same thing was happening with light bulbs and with cigarette lighters, and the chances were, Vickers told himself, that the forever car wasn't the last that would be heard from these manufacturers, whoever they might be. For it must be, he told himself, that those who made the razor blades also made the lighters and the light bulbs, and that those who made the gadget items must have designed the forever car. Not the same companies, perhaps, although he couldn't know, for it had never occurred to him to try to find out who had made any of them. The bus was filling up, but Vickers still sat by himself, staring out the window and sorting out his thoughts. Just behind him, a couple of women were talking, and without consciously trying to eavesdrop, he picked up their words. One of them giggled and said, "We have the most interesting group. So many interesting people in it." And the other woman said, "I've been thinking about joining one of those groups, but Charlie, he says it's all baloney. Says we're living in America in the year 1987, and there's no reason in the world why we should pretend we aren't. Says this is the best country and the best time the world has ever known.
Says we got all the modern conveniences and everything. Says we're happier than people ever been before. Says this pretending business is a lot of communist propaganda, and he'd like to get hold of the ones that got it started. Says, "Oh, I don't know," interrupted the first woman. "It is kind of fun. It takes a lot of work, of course, reading about them old times and all of that, but you get something out of it, I guess. One fellow was saying at a meeting the other night, you get out of it what you put into it, and I guess he's right. But I don't seem to be able to put much into it. I guess I must be the flighty type. I'm not too good a reader, and I don't understand too well, and I gotta have a lot explained to me, but there are them as get a lot out of it, seems like. There's a man in our group living back in London, back in the times of a man called Samuel Pepys. I don't know who this Pepys was, but I guess he was an important man or something. You don't know who Pepys was, do you, Gladys?"
"Not me," said Gladys.
"Well, anyhow," continued the other, "this fella, he talks all the time about this Pepys. He wrote a book, this Pepys, and it must have been an awful long book because he tells about so many things. This man I was telling you about writes the most wonderful diary. We always like to have him read it to us. You know, it sounds almost as if he was really living there."
The bus stopped for a railroad crossing, and Vickers glanced at his watch. They'd be in the city in another half an hour. It was a waste of time, he told himself. No matter what sort of scheme Anne had up her sleeve, it would be a waste of time, for he was not going to allow anything to interrupt his writing. He shouldn't have allowed himself to be talked into wasting even this one day. Back of him, Gladys was saying,
"Did you hear about these new houses they're putting out? I was talking to Charlie about them the other night, and I was saying maybe we ought to look into them. Our place is getting kind of shabby, you know, and we have to paint it and sort of fix it up. But Charlie, he said it was a sucker game of some sort. He said no one would put out them kind of houses on the sort of deal they offer without there was a catch somewhere. Charlie, he said he was too old a hand to be taken in by something like them houses. Mabel, have you seen any of them houses or read anything about them?" "I was telling you," Mabel persisted, "about this group I belong to. One of the fellows is pretending that he's living in the future. Now I ask you, ain't that a laugh? Imagine anyone pretending he's living in the future."
Chapter 5. Outside the door, Ann Carter stopped and said,
"Now please remember, Jay, his name is Crawford. You're not to call him Cranford or Crawham or any other name but Crawford."
Vickers said humbly, "I'll do my very best." She came close to him and tightened his tie and straightened it and flicked some imaginary dust off his lapel.
"We're going out as soon as this is over and buy you a suit," she said.
"I have a suit," said Vickers. The letters on the door read North American Research. "What I can't understand," protested Vickers, "is why North American Research and I should have anything in common."
"Money," said Anne. "They have it and you need it."
She opened the door and he followed her in obediently, thinking what a pretty woman she was and how efficient. Too efficient. She knew too much. She knew books and publishers and what the public wanted, and she was on to all the angles. She drove herself and everyone around her. She was never so happy as when three telephones were ringing and there were 5 dozen letters to be answered and 12 calls to make. She had bullied him into coming here this day, and it was not beyond reason, he told himself, that she had bullied Crawford and North American Research into wanting him to come.
"Miss Carter," said the girl at the desk, "you can go right in. Mr. Crawford is waiting for you."
She's even got the Indian sign on the receptionist, Vickers thought. Chapter 6. George Crawford was a big man who overflowed the chair in which he sat. He held his hands folded over his paunch and talked with no change of tone, with no inflection whatsoever, and was the stillest man Vickers had ever seen. There was no movement in him, nor any sense of movement. He sat huge and stolid, and his lips scarcely moved, and his voice was not much louder than a whisper.
"I have read some of your work, Mr. Vickers," he said. "I am impressed by it."
I'm glad to hear you say so, Vickers said.
3 years ago, I never would have thought that I would ever read a piece of fiction or be talking to its author. Now, however, I find that we need a man like you. I have talked it over with my directors, and we are all agreed that you are the man who could do the job for us.
He paused and stared at Vickers with bright blue eyes that peered out like bullet points from the folds of flesh.
Miss Carter, he said, tells me that at the moment you are very busy.
That is right.
Some important piece of work, I presume, said Crawford.
I hope it is.
This thing I have in mind would be more important.
That, Vickers told him crisply, is a matter of opinion.
You don't like me, Mr. Vickers, Crawford said.
It was a statement of fact, not a question, and Vickers found that it irritated him. I have no opinion of you, he replied. I am totally disinterested in everything except what you have to say.
Before we go any further, said Crawford, I would like to have it understood that what I have to say is of a confidential nature.
Mr. Crawford, Vickers told him, I have little stomach for cloak and dagger business.
This is not cloak and dagger business, said Crawford,
and for the first time there was an edge of emotion in his voice.
It is the business of a world with its back against the wall.
Vickers stared at him, startled. My God, he thought, the man really means exactly what he is saying. He really believes that the world does have its back against the wall.
Perhaps, said Crawford, you have heard of the Forever Car.
Vickers nodded. The garage owner in my hometown tried to sell me one this morning.
And about the everlasting razor blades and the lighter and the light bulbs?
I have one of the blades, said Vickers, and it is the best blade I ever owned. I doubt that it is everlasting, but it is a good blade, and I've never had to sharpen it. When it wears out, I intend to buy another one.
Unless you lose it, you will never have to. Because, Mr. Vickers, it is an everlasting blade. And the car is an everlasting car. Maybe you've heard about the houses, too.
Not enough to matter.
The houses are prefabricated units, said Crawford, and they sell at the flat rate of $500 a room, set up. You can trade in your old home on them at a fantastic trade-in value, and the credit terms are liberal. Much more liberal, I might add, than any sane financing institution would ever countenance. They are heated and air-conditioned by a solar power plant that tops anything, you hear me, anything that we have today. There are many other features, but that gives you a rough idea.
They sound like a good idea. We've been talking about low-cost housing for a long time now. Maybe this is it.
They are a good idea, said Crawford. I would be the last to deny they are. Except that they will ruin the power people. That solar plant supplies it all. Heat, light, power. When you buy one of them, you don't need to tie up to an electric outlet. And they will put thousands of carpenters and masons and painters out of work and in the carbohydrate lines, too. They eventually will wreck the lumber industry.
I can understand about the power angle, Vickers said, but that business about the carpenters and the lumber industry doesn't quite make sense. Surely these houses use lumber, and it must take carpenters to build them.
They use lumber all right, and someone builds them, but we don't know who it is.
You could check, suggested Vickers. Seems rather elementary. There must be a corporate setup. There must be mills and factories somewhere.
There's a company, admitted Crawford. A sales company. We started with that and we found the warehouse from which the units are shipped for delivery after they are sold. But that's the end of it. There is, so far as we can find, no factory that builds them. They are consigned from a certain company and we have its name and address, but no one has ever sold a stick of timber to that company. They have never bought a hinge. They hire no men. They list factory sites, and the sites are there, but there aren't any factories. And to the best of our knowledge, no single person has gone into or come out of the home office address since we've been watching it.
That's fantastic, Vickers objected.
Of course it is, agreed Crawford. Lumber and other materials go into those houses, and somewhere there are men who build them.
Mr. Crawford, just one question. Why are you interested?
Well now, said Crawford, I wasn't quite ready to tell you that.
I know you weren't, but tell me anyway.
I had hoped to sketch in a bit more of the background so that you would understand what I am driving at. Our interest, I might say our organization, sounds just a little silly until you know the background.
Someone has you scared, said Vickers.
You wouldn't admit it, of course, but you're scared livid. Queerly enough, I will admit it. But it's not me, Mr. Vickers. It's industry, the industry of the entire world.
You think the people who are making and selling these houses, said Vickers, are the same ones who are making the Forever car and the lighters and the bulbs? Crawford nodded.
And the carbohydrates, too, he added. It's terrifying when you think about it. Here we have someone who wrecks industries and throws millions out of work, then turns around and offers those same millions the food to live on. Offers it without the red tape and the investigations and all the quibbling that always heretofore has characterized relief.
A political plot.
It's more than that. We are convinced that it is a deliberate, well-planned attack on world economy. A deliberate effort to undermine the social and economic system of our way of life. And after that, of course, the political system. Our way of life is based on capital, be it private capital or state control of resources, and on the wage that the worker earns at his daily job. Take away those two things, capital and jobs, and you have undercut the whole basis of an orderly society.
We? Asked Vickers. Who are we?
North American Research.
And North American Research?
You're getting interested, said Crawford.
I want to know who I'm talking to and what you want of me and what it's all about. Crawford sat for a long time without speaking, and then he finally said,
That is what I meant when I told you what I have to say was highly confidential.
I will swear no oath, said Vickers, if that is what you mean.
Let's go back, said Crawford, and review some history. Who we are and what we are will become apparent then. You remember the razor blade? It was the first to come out. An everlasting razor blade. The news spread quickly, and everyone went out and bought one of the razor blades. Now the ordinary man will get anywhere from one to a half dozen shaves out of a blade. Then he throws that blade away and puts in another one. That means he is a continuous buyer of new razor blades. And as a result, the razor blade industry was a going concern. It employed thousands of workers. Over the course of a year, it represented a certain profit for thousands.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.